The first time I ever went to a pride festival, I was scared and nervous, a little baby trans. I had just come out a little bit before to just a couple of my friends. I had never really gone out in public as a transgender person. And that day, with my friends for safety, I had gone out with just a little bit of overdone makeup on my face, not very well, and a dress that did not fit me well at all. A dress that I just scurried into Walmart, just quickly like said, oh, I'll buy this, and then ran out and didn't even try it on. At that time, even seeing someone kiss someone of the same gender in front of me was something scary and subversive and new, just to see it. So to go to Pride and see people in assless chaps and leather and gimp outfits and all the insanity of it, dear God, it was so intimidating. I was so nervous. I was like a deer in the headlights. It was honestly a little bit too much for me. Well, look at me now. Hello, interwebs. Yes, I know that this costume is a little bit extra, like very extra even for me. It's not exactly what you would call my normal attire, as you would say. Trust me, I do actually have a point to make with why I'm wearing this outfit that I will make by the end of the video. But for now, I know there are several of you who probably enjoy me wearing this outfit. So this is for you, and you know who you are. Kevin. But rainbow pasties aside, it's another day, so we have another discourse. And since Twitter has yet again spun the wheel of discourse, it looks like it's landed on, yes, kink in Pride, and whether or not kink should be allowed at Pride celebrations this June or not. Today's current discourse mainly seems to stem from this viral tweet, which says three things that I 100% agree with, and says for its fourth thing, quote, please don't bring your kinks slash fetishes to Pride. There are minors at Pride and this can sexualize the event. This tweet, which has since been deleted, sparked off a huge debate around kink being at Pride, with articles written in places like the Mary Sue, Them, and My Mother's Basement. Wait, what was that last one? Anyways, there's even videos being posted here on YouTube about it. And we all know once something hits YouTube, you've officially won the Discourse of the Day Award. Congratulations, you're right up there with such people as Gina Carano and that lady from Resident Evil Village that everyone wants to spank.
How dare you try to face me!
But to be honest, this debate around kink at Pride really isn't new. I found articles about it back in 2020, and I also found articles about kink at Pride going back to 2019, 2018, 2017, and on and on and on. Honestly, this discourse is more regular than the amount of times that I call my mom, which, now that I think about it, I should probably do more often. But since this discussion is about as evergreen as my sexiness, I figured it's time for me to take a break from watching the kinkiest Star Trek show. It's Deep Space Nine, come on, how is it not Deep Space Nine? I mean, Quark's ears alone. And I think we can discuss these arguments in good faith. But then, if you'll allow me to be a little bit of a tease, ow, that actually hurt. I actually wanted to talk about why, in some ways, this conversation is actually more insidious than just about kink. Because it actually is about all LGBTQ folks, but especially trans folks today. Oh boy, a trans person making it all about herself. Ugh, I really am an egomaniac. That one's for you, TERFs. That one's for you. Alright, the first argument up in the gauntlet is that Pride is a family-friendly event. Here's a video of a YouTuber sitting in front of some pretty colored lights just to say as much.
Here's my perspective, okay? Pride should be an uncontroversial celebration of queer identity and queer history as a way of A, putting on a good face for the normies, B, giving people who are on the cusps of the community an entry into it, like an opportunity to dip their toes in, C, showing people what it's all about, and D, being fun, okay? The reason why I like these elements is because I think that it works to A, normalize, like, gay people, which is good, that's good, and B, it makes it easier for people who might otherwise not participate in the gay community jump into it. See, that's important, okay? It's important that that happen.
YouTubers and their fancy lighting setups. Anyways, Pride, some folks argue, should be as accessible as popular. Popular? Pride, some folks argue, should be as accessible as possible. And having people walk around in assless chaps, leather daddy outfits, and, you know, rainbow pasties makes the event less accessible, some people say. Some of the reasons may be they have moral issues against it, which we'll be talking about in a little bit later section, or maybe because they have kids at the event who don't want to see such kinky stuff, something we'll also be discussing later on in this video. But before we get to that stuff, let's hone in on this idea of accessibility, about who Pride is for. You see, Pride didn't start off as one big rainbow and glitter explosion party concert, but as a protest. While the infamous Stonewall Riot, an event which was sparked by police raiding the LGBTQ Stonewall Inn in the sexiest of years, 1969, and whipping and hitting patrons, causing the crowd to fight back, and pelting the homophobic cops and causing aggressive street confrontations to happen over the next few nights, wasn't the first LGBTQ-focused riot, it certainly became one of the most well-known. The following year, in recognition of the anniversary of the Stonewall Riot, organizers built upon that sense of resistance to the policing of LGBTQ identities and organized a march down Christopher Street in New York City with the theme of gay pride, as a counterpoint to the prevailing sense of you should be ashamed of being gay that had abounded in mainstream culture up to that point, and still to this day. And soon, like finding glitter on your body, these pride parades soon spread to cities all over the world. Pride didn't start as a family-friendly celebration event. It was meant as a very clear political pushback against a society that shames the very notion of being LGBTQ, not only with its cultural messaging, but with very direct and violent actions and policing. It was meant as a screw you to the establishment. And yes, there were celebration elements of it, celebration of identity, celebration in the form of pride, because pride is a protest. Pride is a way to say, we're here, and we aren't going anywhere, and we are visible. We are told in so many different ways to not be visible, to go away, to hide, to be in the closet, to not be ourselves in public in any way, shape, or form. To be prideful and out is an active act of resistance against that. But as LGBTQ rights have been fought for more and more over the past few years, pride itself has become more and more a commercialized and normalized part of our yearly celebrations. Numerous corporations have sponsored Pride events. There's even Pride-themed merch. Hell, there's even LGBTQ-themed Oreos, which honestly are kind of delicious. Even Google helped fund San Francisco Pride, despite the fact that the company continually refused to properly address homophobic and transphobic harassment on this very platform, YouTube. Not my vagina. Just YouTube. I know I'm pointing at my vagina, but I'm talking about YouTube. Is YouTube in my vagina? Anyways, Pride, in many ways, has become, in some ways, a part of the establishment that it fought against. But to be fair, the reason these groups feel more comfortable sponsoring Pride is because, in many ways, some LGBTQ identities have become normalized in society, have been less shamed, I at least should say, and more people are starting to explore what it might mean to be part of the LGBTQ community. Why did I stumble there? I mean, more and more people are identifying with the LGBTQ spectrum today than ever before. Just look at the statistics. So doesn't it make sense to have an event where people can just come and figure out what it's like? Again, that sort of sampler idea to be like, oh yeah, this is fun. We can just enjoy ourselves. This is sort of like being like, sort of like baby's first gay event. And to a degree, I get this. I too like being like, hey, it's Pride Month, let's just go and have fun with my friends. Hell, I even bring a lot of my straight friends because it's fun to just hang out with them in a space that is, you know, kind of catering to the LGBTQ community. A normal part of our culture, that it's something that we can do out in the open and just have fun. It's something that everyone can enjoy. And this whole feeling gets into this debate. Is Pride a protest, or is Pride meant to be a normalized event to just say, hey, LGBTQ is fun? But, you know, by normalizing Pride, we take it away from those who need it most. I mean, for example, I've seen people saying that Pride is a queer inclusive event. It's not a queer inclusive event. It's a queer event. It's inherently gay. It's not inclusive of gay, it is gay. But by saying that, we're normalizing that Pride isn't for gay people, it's for everyone. It includes us, but it's not for us. But that's not the point. It's for LGBTQ people. I want Pride to be something that everyone can enjoy in some way. I'm not saying that you can't bring your straight friends or that others can't enjoy it, but it shouldn't be meant to be an LGBTQ taste tester either. Pride should be subversive. It shouldn't be normalized. The whole reason we are prideful is because we are told to be ashamed. Pride is a way of pushing back. The whole reason Pride is important is because, for many of us, Pride isn't what we're allowed to feel about ourselves as LGBTQ people. And publicly showing kink at Pride, something that's still considered subversive, goes to the very nature and core of Pride. Kink to this day isn't accepted by society by its very nature. It's about making those who see us uncomfortable, to say you cannot look away from us, that we are here and we are happy to be ourselves and you can't deny that. And you have to reconcile with your uncomfortability with that. to say, I don't care if you're uncomfortable. I'm here, so your uncomfortability is your problem. And kink is still one of the most visible ways to make people uncomfortable. In fact, the kink community has often been at the forefront of many of the protests, going back all the way to the Christopher Street one. It's part of our history, and to exclude people who practice kink because they aren't seen as politically expedient to normalization goes against the very nature of pride and LGBTQ inclusiveness. And by the way, put a little pin in that idea, because we will be coming back to that. Oh yeah, that feels good. Okay, number two. Many people say, well, okay, I get some of that, but kink isn't discriminated against in the way that LGBTQ identities are as a whole, nor does it have the history of discrimination as lengthy as queer folks. And as such, it's not really the same as being gay.
Yes, Pride started out as a reaction against heteronormative sexuality and a fight against the oppression LGBTQ people face. It commemorates the Stonewall Uprising when LGBTQ people fought back against the literal policing of our sexualities. But that was down to an identifiable class of individuals discriminated against in law and culture based on shared characteristics, their sexual orientation and gender expression. This distinction matters. Kink and BDSM are not sexual orientations, but rather sexual preferences. An orientation is innate and immutable. A preference can change. No one is oppressed because they're kinky. Certainly not in any way that is comparable to the past and even current oppression and marginalization faced by LGBTQ people. LGBTQ people built a community and a political coalition because we were oppressed on the basis of who we love and who we are. This gives us a shared struggle and history, as our fight against laws like Section 28 in the UK or Proposition 8 in California illustrate. We have mutual political interests built out of a common oppression.
To this I say, kink actually has a long history of discrimination. Kink has been around as long as humans have. As long as we've been able to fuck, we've been trying to fuck in cool ways. Humans are creative like that. I mean, way back in the 4th century, the Kama Sutra was basically a how to get kinky manual. But as long as there have been joys, there have also been killjoys. For example, the psychiatrist, whose name I'm going to terribly butcher, Richard von Krafft Ebing, who published a book in the early 1900s called Psychopathia Sexalis, which doesn't at all sound demonizing, argued that kink behavior is severely depraved. Additionally, the Catholic Church for many centuries tried to put pressure down on anyone doing anything that they saw as morally depraved, which included anything that even resembled kinkiness. Even to this day, those who take part in the kink community still face discrimination. A UN weapons inspector was pressured to resign after he was outed as a BDSM participant. In the United States, it's perfectly legal, by the way, for an employer to fire someone for private BDSM-related activities, regardless of their performance on the job or whether they even bring it into the job in the first place. And there's very little to protect you from that. Numerous people who practice BDSM can also recall being fired or being reported to HR if any involvement in their BDSM activities was discovered, even if it's something that they didn't even talk about or bring to work.
Also, a study found that 40% of those who practice kink activities had either been discriminated against, had experienced some form of harassment or violence, or had some form of harassment or discrimination aimed at their kink-related businesses. Many also face stigma of being considered mentally ill or sexually abusive or being victims of sexual abuse themselves or having had bad parents. All things that other members of the LGBTQ community face as well, but we'll come back to that. Again, another pin.
But some people argue, well, okay, I get that, but kink is a choice, right? Kink is just something that you're choosing to do. You can just choose not to do it, and maybe it's on you if you get fired or things like that, or if you're discriminated against. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? But we'll come back to that. Again, put another pin in it, so. But even if we ignore the implications of that, as psychologist Tess Gemberling pointed out,
specifically, although theories describing its origin abound, it remains unclear whether BDSM is best conceptualized as a sexual behavior, sexual attraction, sexual identity, and/or sexual orientation for those who practice for sexual purposes. Consistent with a sex-positive framework, BDSM may be best conceptualized as another form of sexual orientation for a percentage of practitioners.
Kink is often so fundamental to our sexual identities that it has to be, at least in some cases, an orientation. Our orientation is so deeply rooted that many of us feel we were born with it. For us, kink mixes language, ritual, trust, power, pleasure, pain, and identity in a way that can't be captured by a stereotype. If you accept this definition, then my kink is my sexual orientation. It's not my choice, it's not my illness, and it's definitely not my hobby.
It may also be helpful, by the way, to point out what kink is. Because we typically think of kink as things like bondage or spanking or, you know, leather. This is kind of faux leather, but close enough. But kink, in many ways, is actually always a moving target. Kink is actually defined as anything that isn't considered normal by society in a sexual context. It's anything deemed weird by culture at large. Today, things like polyamory are still considered to be kinky in some contexts, despite the fact that polyamorous people can practice it safely, consensually, and can also have the most vanilla sex that you've ever seen. Believe me, I have experience with polyamorous people, and they're not as crazy out there as you would think. That is a stereotype. And on that note, everything from gay sex to just being trans has been seen as a kink at some point throughout our history, just within the past 200 years. Kink was even inherently seen as misogynistic very recently. And again, we will be coming back to that, so remember all those pins. Mmm, feels great. So again, pride is about finding pride in the things that society tells you is uncomfortable. So to take kink from pride because it doesn't face discrimination is not only patently false, but again, goes against the very notion of what pride is. This is a difficult one. Consent. When some people argue that when people go to pride, they don't consent to seeing someone in leather or assless chaps or a giant dildo monster.
And honestly, this is the argument that I have some of the most sympathy for. Obviously, we want to be careful when it comes to consent and what people are consenting to in any sort of space, especially when it revolves around sex. And that's something that kink is about too. Kink is all about consent, about doing something between consenting adults, regardless of whatever it is.
And this is an argument I hear quite often, even within my own family. When I spent time in quarantine at my parents' home in New Mexico last year, I actually got into an argument with my very own stepmother about this very topic. She talked about how a few years ago, when she took my younger sister, who was 16 at the time, to her first pride event, she, my stepmom, was very uncomfortable just walking around and seeing how quote-unquote sexualized the event was. She argued that she shouldn't have to see that. Why do gay people need to be so out there? Don't they just want to be, you know, politically expedient? Don't they want to just be seen as normal, just be like everyone else? This idea of consent, this idea of like, well, she was there and she didn't consent to see these, what she saw as sexual things in her purview. But the thing is, she chose to be there. Yes, she was bringing my sister who wanted to be there, but it was her choice to do that. Does she have the right to police other people in public for wearing stuff because she chose to be in a space that she didn't have to be in? Why is it incumbent on others around you to hide themselves because you're uncomfortable? And where does that stop? You can say, oh, that guy has assless chaps, cover yourself up. Oh, that girl's skirt is a little bit too short, she should wear a longer one. Oh, that person looks just even slightly sexy to me, they should cover up their entire body. You see where I'm going with that? You see how that spirals out into things where we are controlling and policing other people's bodies because of something that we feel? Because of our uncomfortability? Again, it keeps coming back to the same feeling that someone else is making someone feel uncomfortable. And so they say that they should feel shame, that they should cover up, that they should hide themselves because someone else feels uncomfortable. You're putting your feelings onto someone else and telling them they should feel shame for something that you're feeling. Again, pride is about celebrating ourselves and our bodily openly. If you're uncomfortable, you don't have to be there. Now, I'm not saying that pride has to be this debaucherous place where everything's just going crazy and it's like insanity in the streets. I'm not saying that you have to be involved in sex acts that you don't want to be involved in, but also, no one is doing that at Pride. No one is fucking in the middle of the street at Pride. There are 18 plus areas at every Pride event that I know of that people can go into and choose to go into. But again, those are areas that you choose to go into.
But also, just to be clear, I've been focusing on the extreme end of this line of thought when it comes to consent. Yet, I also totally understand and accept that there should be some spaces at Pride that focus on the sex-averse or sex-repulsed, or those who don't want to be around kink or anything that they might consider to be sexual. For example, there are those like my stepmom who I love and I would love to have her feel comfortable coming with me to a Pride event. There's also members of the asexual and other communities who are sex-repulsed. There are also some folks who are just uncomfortable with sex in general, especially considering how much of our society mystifies sex, and I totally understand wanting to create a space for them too, and that's just as necessary. They are just as much a part of this community and should be allowed at Pride. But I also don't think we need to pit one against the other. We should try to create spaces for both as best we can, while also recognizing that there are no perfect solutions. This is an ongoing conversation that needs to happen at each and every Pride event to see what is possible in each community. As always, it's a discussion, not a dictation or overriding rule. And also, just to be entirely clear here, if someone is in the middle of Pride or in public doing an explicitly sexual act and then just trying to defend themselves saying like, oh, it's just kink, I'm just doing kink at Pride, I think that that needs to be pushed back against and that can be considered breaking consent. However, I have to say that that is a very nuanced conversation. While some things may be obviously like everyone would agree that is sexual, there are gray areas that make it really difficult to talk about, and I think it just needs to have a discussion. Because, as we will talk about in our final section, what is considered sexual has always been a moving target and sometimes been weaponized against marginalized communities. But we'll get to that in just a moment.
But there are folks who want to police people's activities just by being around them, or even further, police what people do in their own spaces that they aren't even privy to because it riles them up that people are even doing something that they see as subversive or shameful because they can't stop thinking about it. Which means another point, another pin. I love this. And this brings us to the final one, that pride should be family friendly. We should think of the children, please, please think of the children. This think of the children narrative that this always centers on. Never mind the fact that, again, parents are the one choosing to bring their kids there. That parents can choose or not choose to bring their kids if it's something that they feel isn't safe for their kids to be around.
And to be very clear here, this is an incredibly nuanced discussion. I get not wanting to expose kids to things that society or their parents may consider too sexual for their age. And I also do think that parents should be allowed to feel comfortable bringing their kids to Pride without worry that they might be exposed to something that their parents feel that they aren't ready for, or that we as a society or a culture feel that kids aren't ready for. Yeah, again, I don't think this needs to be a zero-sum game. I think we can create family-friendly spaces, or maybe even days where certain things are and aren't allowed, to enable everyone to feel like they can participate comfortably, but also express themselves in a way that is subversive or expresses who they are. And if you're a parent who doesn't want their kid to see kink at Pride, I totally understand. But to try to dictate the entirety of a Pride event based on this concept goes against the very notion of what Pride should be about, in my opinion, and can be just as ostracizing to those who feel the opposite of what we've been arguing here. People who feel like they want to be able to express kink at Pride should have an ability to do so. It doesn't have to be a zero-sum game though, and it doesn't have to be an infighting thing, but again, we should create that discussion. My issue really is saying that it has to be one thing or the other, and always using kids as the way to do that. Because you know what all or nothing arguments sound like to me? A binary. And you know what I say to binaries? Fuck that.
But I also think that in some ways it's healthy to normalize sex and sexuality. Now, let me be clear here. I am not saying that kids should be involved in sexual acts or anything like that. No, 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 no. But that straw man idea, that that's what I'm saying, feeds into this repeated refrain that LGBTQ folks are pedophiles trying to harm and sexualize your children. But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about letting kids have a healthy relationships with sex and sexuality at a slower pace instead of a way where we just hide it away so no one ever sees it, no one ever talks about it, and so kids feel a sense of like mystery and shame around the very concept of sex. Again, there are 18 plus areas where kids aren't allowed in, so public spaces are different. Kids don't need protecting from the very notion of sex or sexuality. That's the very puritanical attitude that Pride is all about fighting. This idea that sex is a scary thing that kids should never even hear a whisper about. Again, I'm not saying that kids need to know all the details, and there are different ages to talk about different things, and that's up to every single parent. But it's also healthy to expose kids to understanding that sex and sexuality is something normal, so that they don't grow up with that internalized shame. As someone myself who grew up in a Roman Catholic family who was so goddamn sexually repressed, the only time they were able to even talk about sex was in the dirtiest of jokes around the Christmas tree, believe me, I have stories. I know what it feels like to feel sexual shame well into adulthood because I wasn't taught that sex was normal. Even right now, I feel shame at my body and wearing this outfit because I feel kind of gross and nasty and wrong to do so. But it's my body. And sex is okay, and being sexy is okay, and showing my body is okay. But I have all that internalized shame, and I wish I could have been taught that that was normal. And that's healthy to teach kids at a young age, to not be ashamed of themselves or sex or their bodies. Remember that story of my stepmom going to Pride? Well, she went because my sister wanted to go. You see, my sister had been going through a lot of crap at that time. She was 16, and I'm not going to share her story because that's hers to tell. But suffice it to say, she had gone through some shit. Like a lot of shit. Shit that scared my whole family and me. But going to Pride meant a lot to her. It let her see that some of the feelings that she was having, some of the things that she was struggling with, weren't weird or awful or strange. They could be, in some context, normal. And getting to see those kinky things that so bothered my stepmother made my sister feel okay for once in a very long time. And my sister isn't a kinky person at all, but the whole idea of being LGBTQ was seen in her mind to be kinky. So to just be at this event, where people were taking pride in these feelings, something that she had been told to feel ashamed of, and even going even further beyond that and saying, like, even this far, is okay and normal and fine. So with someone that she was feeling was a little bit pulled back from that, that was important to her, even though she was a kid. The same for me, by the way. You know, I was a scared trans person too, who wasn't sure if I wanted to come out, if I felt safe, if I could be prideful, or I could be happy as a trans person. And going to Pride, seeing people go the extra mile, going super far, even further than what I would normally consider to be just a, you know, vanilla trans person, that made me feel good. It's like, okay, if that's okay, maybe I am too. And seeing other trans people there made me feel like, okay, I'm okay too. And you see, we've come full circle. Because by arguing to protect kids from this stuff, is actually saying, you want them to come to learn that this stuff is shameful. Something to be hidden away in a closet. To never let anyone know that they feel. Now that definitely sounds familiar. All right, time to take out all those pins because it's time to talk about this. I've been trying to keep this conversation mainly focused around kink, but it's been really hard to do that because this whole conversation honestly revolves around everything the LGBTQ community fights back against. As I said, kink has never been defined as just like leather daddies and bondage and things like that. Kink is always seen as anything defined as abnormal, sexual, and strange by society. And all of these arguments used against what we see today as kink at Pride are actually just stepping stones to larger discrimination against the LGBTQ community as a whole. Take, for example, this article that was written just last year arguing against kink at Pride.
Unsurprisingly, the social media reaction to the suggestion that fetishists be formally included in Pride marches was somewhat hostile. Many ordinary lesbian, gay, and bisexual people who have only laterally shed the stigma of being sexual deviants were angry at the association. Unlike homosexuals, people with fetishes have no history of discrimination, so one wonders what further rights or acceptance they wish to gain.
Seems like this article is pretty much just saying everything that we've been talking about, right? It's just saying all the arguments that I've laid out. But the article takes all that and goes a little bit further.
For many years, risque gay men have pushed the boundaries of public decency at Pride marches with arseless chaps and egregious displays of exhibitionism. But arguably, the addition of the T to the LGB has turbocharged this trend towards sexual display. It might not be politically correct to admit it, but for many men, transgenderism is a form of fetish, a step up from cross-dressing. It seems public sympathy for the former has opened the door to the latter, and hot on their heels, a host of fetishists have followed. Being sexually excited by the thought of oneself as a woman, or a rubber-clad sex slave or adult baby might be a genuine urge, but it is quite different from loving someone of the same sex.
So that article goes from kinky to saying, well, being transgender or transsexual in their terms is just a fetish. It's just kink. You see, this argument about kink at Pride isn't simply an intellectual one. It's a very real and violent one. All the arguments used against kink that I outlined are the same exact arguments being used against trans people and weaponized against trans people today. In 2017, TERF lesbians marched in front of the Pride in London parade, demanding that transgender people be pushed out of Pride because we're kinky, a sexual fetish that's deeply misogynistic. We're seen as narcissistic men trying to take over Pride from women and the gays. Literally every video I do on TERFs and trans issues, I'm called a narcissist for wanting to make it all about me and trying to make you deal with my fetish, my creepy sexualized act. When I'm just trying to point out the discrimination faced by not just trans people, but LGBTQ people as a whole. If anything, I'm more a narcissist for being a YouTuber than I am for being trans. But TERFs and society as a whole are arguing that we're forcing our fetish onto unconsenting eyes just by being trans people in a space. TERFs argue that trans women aren't discriminated against because we're just men who can take off our makeup at the end of the day. And we're seen as hurting the children with our sexual fetish. I mean, look at all these anti-trans laws, such as the law that just passed in Tennessee that will force businesses to place signs on their doors saying they let people of either biological sex use the bathroom. Which feeds into the narrative of trans people as sexual deviants trying to hurt the children, trying to hurt women in these private spaces. That's the rhetoric being used against trans people, that by affirming transgender healthcare, it's hurting the kids. By letting trans people in sports, we're hurting the children. That transness is a sexual deviancy used to hurt the children. If we let others dictate to us what is sexual, what is appropriate, then it can quickly escalate and destroy the entire point of what pride is in the first place. Because you see, even what we see as kinky stuff outside of the LGBTQ context isn't always sexual. Sometimes people just like to wear fun outfits and costumes, and you're the one that's finding it overtly sexual.
As celebrated trans theorist Julia Serrano pointed out on Twitter, I'm waiting for the point in the No Kink at Pride discourse where we consider how weaponizing consent to call out people we see but don't interact with, who are also dressed too sexual in our minds, potentially dilutes legitimate claims of non-consent in cases of actual sexual violence. Also, the fact that we're even having this discussion why IRL TERFs actually claim, using disproven AGP theory, that because trans women are supposedly, quote, perpetually aroused, end quote, by wearing women's clothing, our very presence in public is tantamount to a non-consensual sex act. When I see people in public wearing wedding rings, they are, quote, non-consensually involving me in their sexual relationships, end quote. There is seriously no end to these claims. If any time anyone wears something others interpret as, quote, sexual, it gets conflated with sexual violence. Respectability politics is nothing new at Pride. If you don't like the sexy dressing people who attend, frame it in those terms, like you all used to. But don't appropriate actual language intended to challenge actual direct incidents of sexual violence to make your point.
I'm not saying we expose kids to sex acts and activities. I'm just saying that we shouldn't be putting shame into kids about what it's like to feel like you're a part of the LGBTQ community. That we can talk about sex and sexuality in a healthy way. And I'm also saying that what we talk about to kids is always debated, always being told to us what is right or wrong. Because today, being transgender isn't socially acceptable in many parts of the world. It's seen as a sexual deviancy. But it used to be lesbians, gay folks, bisexuals that were seen as kinky and needing to be hidden away. To not expose the children to our creepy fetish, when honestly, exposing children to LGBTQ identities is not only okay, but it's important. Pride is meant to make those uncomfortable analyze their uncomfortability. This outfit, for example, that I've been wearing this whole video probably made some of you uncomfortable. Hell, it's made me feel uncomfortable, as I talked about before. This isn't a costume that I would wear during sex. This really isn't the sexual thing that I would do. You know, this is just a fun costume for me to wear in this video. When I want sex, I have my Supergirl and Star Trek onesies for that. But that's the point. The reaction against me sharing my body as a woman, as a trans person, and as someone who has sexual agency is subversive because society has made it so. Women should be able to show their breasts in public just like men can show their nipples. Trans people should be able to exist in public spaces like YouTube videos just like cis folks. And this costume is only a hair more risque than items that I've seen being sold at Target around Halloween. But it's only in these specific contexts when it comes to LGBTQ identities or these spaces that you see it as something sexual. That you see it as something that makes you uncomfortable. Analyze why you're uncomfortable, because that's the point. It's not our job to hide it away in the closet. It's for you to understand why you're uncomfortable and choose to engage or not engage with it. But that's your choice, not mine. Kink is an inherent part of pride. Not only because every LGBTQ identity was considered kinky at some point, not only because it's a healthy part of human interaction, but because kink reminds us of what we are all still fighting against. The right to exist publicly without being seen as sexual, political, or shameful. To have pride in everything that it means to be human, especially the parts of us that are kinky. All right, well, in case you thought I was kidding about the Supergirl onesie, no, this is my sexual. God, I'm a nerd. Anyways, thank you so much for watching this video. This is gonna be an interesting one. I already know that this video is going to be flagged for like adult content and things like that, which is kind of going against the entire point of the video, but YouTube likes the YouTube. So please, if you liked this video, if you liked what I had to discuss here, please, please, please share this, like it, comment on it. Obviously, I know use your discretion on where you share it. I don't wanna like share it in places that people wouldn't feel comfortable with it, but I would really appreciate if anybody could share this video out because I know it's not going to do well in the algorithm at all, despite the outfits that I wore for it. So I would greatly appreciate if you could share it out. Also, I'd love to hear all your thoughts down in the comments below. I know that this is a contentious topic, and I know I probably had some contentious views, but I am open to the discussion. I by no means am ever saying that I am always 100% right. I'm just sort of presenting my research, my views, and I want to have the discussion with all of you. So there's no 100% right or wrong answer, as long as we're focusing on trying to be inclusive and kind to as many people as possible. So let's have that discussion down below. Also, don't forget you can help me out on my Patreon page where you can support me doing what I do. I also have a secondary channel where I just geek out and nerd about nerdy things like this called Jessie Gender After Dark, which now I'm realizing kind of makes the sexual connection to my nerdiness even more explicit. I didn't even consider that. Anyways, beyond all of that, I hope that you, as always, live long and prosper. It's time for Pride Month and time to celebrate my Patreons. Catherine Lambeth, Miranda Janelle, Ashley Allen, Bo Kikio, Eli Bergmas, Morgan the Pirate Queen, Ashlyn Solstice, Greg Gillum, James Elizabeth, Stephen Kleinard, Randy Thompson, Barbara Ruski, Samuel Howard, Felicia Toast, Alex, Boyd and Mary Beth, Earl, Wellington Marcus, Stephen Schuhart, Kate Mikitin, Bush, April Struck, Bass, A Man Chooses, A Slave Obeys, Corian Vale Honkinen, James Krivda, Ish the Mad, Dominic Noble, Buttoneer, Jessica Wright, Jared Johnson, Peter Landers, Ferengito, John Steele, Carmen Olson, Meadow Whisperer, William Stewart, Maggie the Goblin, Ulysses the Pagan, Melinda Walters, Joy A, Alex Owen, Barbara Halechuk, Hieresis, The Auth 13, Jason Knott, John Weatherby, Celestial Dawn, Lamia, Sky Skinner, Andrew K, Maeve, Nathan Steele, Sean Piper, Tiffany Danger, Flynn, Troy Stull, Sky Dodo, Amanda Comet, Ava Knevia, Geek Filter, Janie Peckard, Polymina Din, Laura Demereaux, Marina Carr, Gretchen Badger, Ellie O'Dare, Sarah Bystam, W. Randy E.D., Jacob Tovar, Strawberry Pup Tart, Keith Briggs, Pissed and Twisted Garage, Lysa, Mountain Harpy, Jessica Chapman, Andrew Lamoureux, Sarah Sweeney, Nikki Gordon Bloomfield, Emily Loomis, Mari Mack, Zone 1 Librarian Ver, Jenny Mabel, Michael Hardy, Pasty, Michael Godey, Philip Hawkins, Andy H. You're the best. I love all of you. You're freaking amazing. Thank you so much for making this possible. Happy Pride, everybody.